Okay, so hi everyone, welcome to my lightning talk on Neo4j plugins. I'm Bert Radke, I'm member of the professional services team here in Europe. We help our customers being successful with their craft projects. So what are Neo4j plugins? Well, Neo4j plugins provide a way of extending the core functionality of Neo4j with your own code. Neo4j is written in Java and runs inside the JVM. So in order to extend the functionality of Neo4j, you have to write Java classes and make them available to Neo4j. You do this by packaging them as Java file and put them inside the plugins folder of your Neo4j installation. At startup, Neo4j scans the plugin folder, finds the Java file and loads them inside the JVM. This also means that your code will live inside the same JVM as the core database, meaning it has to share resources with them, memories, threads, and so on. You have to treat carefully of what you're doing there, otherwise you could harm the database. So how does Neo4j find your code, or basically find the code you want to make available to the end user? Well, you annotate them with either procedure or user function. This is an example of how it would look like. So you have, you annotate a function with a procedure, providing a name. This example, get relationship types here in this example, is the final name of the code of your procedure, and you use it with the call function of Cypher. You can also provide the mode, meaning read or write, specifying if your procedure will change the state of the database or not, or if it's just reading or writing. Specifying read and trying to write will lead to an exception. You can also provide a description to the end user, so the end user knows what to expect of your procedure. And finally, you have the actual Java function specification. And here you see that it returns a stream. Procedures always need to return a stream of objects. And what the objects you return need to be something that the Neo4j bolt driver can actually handle. You can also specify parameters for your function and annotate them with a name. So in this case, the node here. So what APIs do you have available inside your procedures? Well, it's Java. So every functionality of the SDK is available to you. If this is not enough, you can even use external dependencies or external Java files, put them inside your Java file and extend your code with them. So there's a lot of flexibility because the Java SDK is quite huge and helpful. Neo4j also provides additional functionality to you to actually access the database. One of these are what I call injectables. So in your classes, and this has to be a class that has at least one procedure annotated function in it, you can provide members with this context annotation. And by specifying a class name, you basically tell Neo4j what kind of object you want to get injected. So then inside your procedure, you can just rely that they are there and you can use them. Let's talk about them in more detail. So lock. Lock lives inside this class and provides you access to the logging facilities of Neo4j. As a logging facilities, you expect something like local levels, of course, and different as you use from other implementations. And then you have, of course, placeholders. So in this example, we lock something on the info level and have a placeholder there with a numeric value. The syntax they use is basically the same as the string format functionality that you use from other things. Just to keep in mind, this is not log4j or slf4j or whatever. This is a custom implementation inside Neo4j. So you can log things. Where do these logs entries being pushed into? It's the Neo4j log in your log file, typically. Unless you start Neo4j with the console command, then it's on your console. Transactions is another thing you can ask to get injected. So with this class, you can get injected the transaction. What kind of transaction do you get? Well, it's the transaction the user had created before calling your procedure. So the external basically transaction. And this is the starting point for most of the things you will do inside your procedures. You normally start asking the procedure for either creating a node, as in this example here, or finding nodes by certain label and property names. So transactions are the core point where you can start with. The other thing, which is not as that often used, but still helpful, is the graph database service. You can ask to get injected. In this main use, it is basically to start your own transactions, and you will see it later on. Could also ask it for the database name, if this is something you care about in your procedure, basically seeing what database the current user is calling you against. So this was the injectables. The other part you have is the, what we call the core Java API. To see what it would look like, I would try to turn the cipher statement here, quite simple, into Java code. So the cipher statement is extremely simple. We basically look for a person with the name Tom Hanks, follow the directed the relationship to the movies, and then collect the movie titles into a set. This is how it would look like in Java. Let's go over this in detail. So from the transaction, as I explained before, you call the find function, specifying the label of the label or labels of the node you're looking for, and the property name, in this case name, and the value of the property, in this case Tom Hanks. This will use an index if there's an index on the label and name property here, and it will return null if there's no such node in the graph, or if there are multiple nodes in the graph with this property value, it will throw an exception because you ask for a single node. There's also a function called find nodes where you get an iterable and can then handle them. So the next step is we're taking this the Hanks node or the person node we just found, and then we ask for the relationships of the nodes, specifying the direction we want to go, so outgoing, and the relationship type by name, so directed in this case. For easier use, we wrap this into Java Stream support. And then we, from the relationship, we follow to the end node, mapping it to the end node. So our stream is now a stream of nodes. From the stream of nodes, we access the property title. And in the end, it's just simple Java code collecting them into a set and return them maybe to the user or whatever you want to do. So you can see there's a lot of things missing here. It didn't do any error checking, any exception handling, any null checks. You would normally do this. Make code even more verbose compared to the cipher. And before, you can already see it's cipher's a lot more compact in code than this. A warning also on threads and transactions in Neo4j, and you use them in your plugin. As I said, you can create your own threads and have to be careful because transactions are always bound to a thread. So yeah, if you create a new thread for maybe traversing a graph in parallel, you would need to create a new transaction in each of the threads because you can't share transactions between the threads. The other thing is entities are basically proxies that are scaled to a transaction. So in the example before, we said tx find node, then by label and so on. We get back an entity, which is actually a proxy. If you try to use this, pass this node over to another thread with a new transaction and try to access it from there, you will get an exception. So we can't pass them over to new threads. So what do you do? You basically pass over the internal node ID. So from the, in the old thread, you say node get ID, you get a long value, which is basically the pointer to the address of the node in the store file. And you use this node ID, pass it over to your new thread. And in the new thread, before you actually try to access the node, you have to, with the new transaction, say get node by ID, providing the node ID. So it's just something to be careful, because otherwise you get really funny exceptions if you're errors with you, if you're not doing it correctly. Then you have the traversal API, so the core API is basically what I explained. You find nodes, and from the nodes you start traversing manually by following relationships from this node, and maybe from there to the end node, and then to the next relationship, and so on. You have to do this all manually. To help you with traversals, there's also traversal API. The traversal API, so the core concept is that you provide a traversal API with some configuration, which includes callback objects that get called when the traversal API walks the graph and then coming back to you, and you can decide what to do. So let's go over this. The traversal description is basically a builder pattern. You start creating it from transactions. And here, then in this case, we specify a uniqueness level saying during the traversal, every node will be only visited once. So there are multiple uniqueness levels in there, only once. So you don't have to care about this anymore. You can specify if you want to go breath first or depth first in the traversal. And then you provide one of these callback objects I mentioned before is an expander. An expander is basically an interface that gets handled a node and returns a stream or an iterable of relationships the traversal API should follow. So basically you get a node, find the relationships you're interested in, and there you can do filtering on properties, even look ahead. And so there's a lot of things you can do, a lot of flexibility. And pass it back, and the traversal API will take care of following it. Another thing you need to provide is an evaluator. Evaluators are also handed the nodes, and they get to decide what to do. So you, depending on the return value of your evaluator, the traversal will stop. It is not going deeper in there. You can decide if you want to have this node being part of the returned object set, so basically what you want to do. So these are the things of how you configure it. To actually start the traversal, you need to call this traverse function there and provide it with one or multiple start nodes. And then the traversal will take care of doing all this manual stuff and all the stuff for you, basically just calling you. The traversal API is quite huge, it's quite powerful. I mentioned only a few things here. If you're interested in more, there's a blog post of mine under this URL where I try to go in much more depth in what is available there. So I think I need to hurry up quite a bit. So testing. Of course, we provide also support for testing. So there's the test harness of Neo4j. It integrates this with JUnit. And as you can see here, just a simple example on how to set this up. So on the class level, you specify that your Neo4j embedded instance will be only created once per class. You build your driver configuration, root member, and then in the before function, basically before any other test gets run, you create your in-process Neo4j. Disable the servers because you don't need any HTTP functionality in there. You put in the class you actually want to test. So in this case, the join class. I could optionally provide some cipher statements in there to load some starting data, and then you build it and it's available. So in the actual test functionality, you can use this as is shown here. So from the embedded database, you construct a driver object. From the driver object, your session, and from the session, then you call your procedure, get something back. You can check the results or check if another call to the database, if your procedure created or changed the objects you wanted to create. So this is how you basically test Neo4j. It's quite helpful. It's also helpful. It enables you to debug through your code. So this is all very exciting, and we techies like to do this kind of things, but you should consider if you actually need a plugin. So there are some reasons where you wouldn't need them, otherwise I wouldn't be holding this talk. It provides you with a lot of flexibility, more flexibility than Cypher has right now. So if you have complex business rules on you need to take care of during your expansion, then plugins are the only way right now. It's also the only way right now to have a parallel graph traversal in place. And it's also a way of providing custom auth providers. But within Neo4j, now providing single sign-on on out of the box, I don't see many users and customers actually needing this anymore. On the minus side, as you have seen, you have to write a lot more code and to maintain it. Deployments of a plugin always require a server restart. So that's quite hard. Yes, I'm hurrying up. It's not available on Aura, and if you run into performance problems, there's no explainer profile, as you know from Cypher, to actually help you with. So this is big drawback, actually. If you still want to go to there, so there's a template repository on GitHub you can use. It has already the examples. Some of them I used in this talk. Test infrastructure, build infrastructure, everything in place. And I think I'm done on time mostly. Thanks for listening. And as this was a very short thing and actually planned this for a full session, I actually also created a blog post about this. So if you want to read up on this, please follow the link. And yeah, thank you for listening.
Thank you, Bert. And I mean, you do have a few questions, but I would suggest you answer that directly on the platform.
Yeah. Okay, I look into this.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.